Next, we'll talk about ABBYY FlexiCapture's FlexiLayout Studio and how it can capture tables. It's a very powerful tool. We'll begin with talking about what a table looks like, and then talk about creation steps and what are the components in the table element, followed by a discussion of the table block. So when you create a table, you do create a block, you create a table element, and the data that's targeted includes the header data, which is really the column headers, such as quantity and unit price. And the footer is optional. It's something like the word discount that can tell the software, I'm done collecting table data, and in between that is the body. Technically, the header is optional, and the footer is optional, but if there is a header and a footer, it can really help you capture table data. So creation steps. The first thing you need to do in FlexiLayout Studio is to create a table block and include the column names. The column names can have no spaces or special characters. Go from left to right. Then you create your table element. The first thing you do when you create your table element is you link it to your table block, and all the column names come in from the table block. If you forgot any, you've got to go back to the table block. Then we've got a variety of tools that we can configure to specify the order of columns, header parameters, footer parameters, more detail on the columns, how to divide rows up, and we can still do search conditions like left of this, right of this, above this, below that. And then finally, we map our table after we test it back to the table block. So some of the configuration changes include specifying a column order, and you can leave this blank, but if you've got variations in your column orders, you can use a rule that kind of gives the software information like, hey, this reference column is on the left, this total column is on the right, but the columns in between may shift around. Or you can serially specify a number of static fixed table, like the orders of columns. So we can just list a whole bunch of different ones rather than use a rule. And by default, FlexiLayout Studio is going to look for a header. It's going to try to find that text above each column. And there are some setting changes here as to whether or not the header is optional, is found on all pages, and so forth. By default, the footer, searching for a footer is turned off in the table element. And you can turn that on. Oftentimes, if a table stops collecting data before it gets through the entire table, usually it's because it found a big white gap and it thinks that the table has ceased. But by specifying a footer, some text at the bottom of the table, you can ensure that the table search goes, it doesn't stop prematurely. And you might have description rows that have many rows of data, whereas your, say it's an invoice, your total is going to be only one line, your quantity. So FlexiLayout Studio has automatic row detection, but you can also specify a master column, and that means provide a column that only has one line per row, and it will use that information to properly collect the multi-line elements of your row, like a description element or column. And after you've built your layout and your element is your table element's working, you've tested it out, you want to make sure that you remember to map that table to that table block. There's really no getting around that. And here's an example of some flexi layout language. So usually it's a manual mapping of the block, but you can also write flexi layout language such as this language, which looks at a couple of different tables and figures out which one has more rows and maps the table with the greater row count. We certainly support multiple page tables. So when tables cross page boundaries, by default, FlexiLayout Studio is ready for that. And you really don't need to do extra work. If you have problems with this, you can play with the header settings, play with the footer settings, and usually FlexiLayout Studio will jump in even when header names aren't carried over into subsequent pages, like maybe page one has a header, but page two and page three and subsequent pages do not, FlexiLayout Studio still does a great job of finding that table continuation across page boundaries. And if a page occurs multiple times on a single page, or if tables have other data kind of sandwiched in between the top and bottom of the table, you can build a repeating group and put a table in that repeating group so that you're successful capturing table data from those kind of scenarios. So we covered a lot of ground very quickly here. The first step in creating a table in FlexiLayout Studio is to create a block and include the column names from left to right. Then create the table element and point to that table block. Column names will come down, and at that point you can describe the element properties, header, footer, rows, quite a few different settings that you can play with as needed to get your FlexiLayout table collection working just perfectly. And when you've hit that point, be sure to map your block, your table block, to your table element.